I'm Eric Clapton, musician, and I'm here to answer some questions. The trick they got together with the propaganda was making it so that you're responsible for other people's lives. So I can be labeled a murderer, and people would really believe that. That's powerful. It's very clever. When they started to talk about rolling out the vaccine, I smelled a rat again. You know, just the way the focus was on this, and there was a race, and then it became political and national. And I thought, here we go again. It's the same old shit. But I was diagnosed with emphysema a couple of years ago, and I thought, well, I fit that bracket. That's pretty vulnerable. I mean, I'm 76. And if there is such a thing as this, and we didn't know anybody, you know, where I lived, there was nobody that we could, even friends of friends of friends were. It was thin on the ground. I thought, well, I ought to have this vaccination for my kids, you know, just to, so that I don't want to drop dead on them, or I don't want them to lose me. I don't want to lose them. All these, the normal natural responses, I think. And then I went and I got the notification, you can come and get, and I was holding out for AstraZeneca because it came from Oxford. And so, you know, I'm pretty naive about this stuff. And I thought, well, that's good. And also I'd heard that it was old school method of inoculation. And I went and had the jab, and I got a little green, like a library card. And I thought, well, that's what I'm going to show the people when I get on the plane. There's a lot of funny stuff about it. And within several hours, I was shaking like a leaf, and I went to bed early, and I couldn't get warm. And I did. And I thought, am I running a fever? I was boiling hot and sweating, and then I was cold. And I was out for the count for about a week. And I had been preparing for a project where I was going to be playing acoustic guitar with a couple of musicians, and we were going to film it. That week knocked me out, and I had to start again from scratch. And I was okay, but it didn't come off as well as I would like to. Because I would professionally, it was a huge setback. And it frightened the shit out of me because I didn't know how long it would last. I then started to find out more. And it was about that time that I ran into somebody. Oh, I said, well, here's my number. We swapped numbers. He was on Telegram. So I contacted him, and he told me about a channel where I could find lots of information and a lot of support. And so I logged on to that. There's a chap called Robin Minotti who runs a channel, and it's for anybody that's concerned or is looking for, in my case, looking for support. For me, I'd felt so alone up until that point. I really couldn't talk to my family and my kids. My teenagers were, it seemed like they'd been brainwashed. And there was a lot of that kind of going on from other protests that were happening earlier. It was the first time I'd seen my kids passionate about anything, and I thought it was great, but I was being ostracized. And I could feel that everywhere. I could feel alienation because I held a different view. So I was trying to keep my mouth shut, but I was following the channel avidly, and bit by bit I realized that I probably shouldn't have had the first jab, but then I was offered the second. And I thought, well, what have I got? What's the point in, you know, stopping now? So I went and had the second, and then it got really bad. And within about a week, I had lost, my hands didn't really work. I suffered from a condition already called peripheral neuropathy, which is nerve damage pain, really. Which means that, you know, I can get numb or pins and needles. When I had the second jab, and they do say that condition, by the way, is progressive and it's incurable. So I had expected it to be, it's manageable. I expected it to be something that would gradually grow worse as I got older into my 80s or whatever. But always, you know, I could get some ice pack or whatever, it would be fine. This went ramped up from, on a scale of 10, say, from 3 to 8 or 9. Agony and chronic pain is not, you know, when you know that nothing will work, there's no medication you can take that will help, is very, very frightening. And the worst thing is you don't know when it's going to wear off or when it's going to go away. So that was, you know, that was what frightened me the most, medically, health-wise. And it still does, because I have gigs to do, I have recording work to do, but I can't, to touch the guitar, to play the guitar, is not fun. And it's something I do, you know, then when I put it down, it's there until I go to bed, and I take sleeping pills because I can't sleep because of the pain. And that's not, it's not a good way to live. But and it's not all due to the vaccine, but the vaccine took my immune system and just shook it around again. And that's still going on. So, and that's, then I read, you know, a lot of the evidence that I had been reading about with people that were having adverse reaction. That was on the list, was, you know, damage to the immune system.
Do you feel like you were made aware of those risks beforehand?
Oh, God, no. God, no, I didn't even know there was a yellow card report. I didn't know there was any such thing. My doctor said, oh, you should, my GP here in London said, because I had to get it done on NHS with an NHS doctor that I've known too from in the country for a long time. He didn't say anything. They gave me a leaflet for the first jab, which I didn't really look at, but they didn't say anything about adverse reactions. They do say you might feel a bit sore, or, you know, like you'd say for a, but they did say also they're safe. You know, it's effective and safe. And I called my the NHS doctor after the second jab, and I said, I've been told there's a yellow card system that, where I can complain about after effects. He said, yes, have you, are they still go? Because I had told them about, you know, and he said, well, I'll fill in the report. And so I never saw a yellow card. I mean, that apparently that's stays with the doctor, but I didn't, you know, that stuff was not made known. I lost the use of my hands for about 3 weeks. So I thought I was in real trouble. And that's about that point. I was invited by Robin Minotti to talk about it because, and it was easy to say yes, because I realized that I'm definitely, by then I realized I wasn't the only one that was suffering adverse reactions. And you know, I can't touch anything cold or hot. I have to use these. Otherwise my hands will begin to burn and they'll stay burnt all day. Whether or not I have gigs to do in the autumn, I know maybe vitamin D will help. There's not much else that does do anything other than being really careful. And that, you know, that's my experience from having had the second jab. And I went to my doctor pretty quickly and said, you know, I can't have any more vaccinations. This is not possible for me because I don't know what will happen. I don't know what will happen next. And from what I read and from what I've been told, there would be a booster in the autumn. And I said, I have to have a document that says, I'm allergic. I can't have COVID vaccine, which I have in my backpack next door. And I don't, you know, I don't know where that will lead me, because the next thing I be, you know, through it all, actually, the point that I should have made earlier is that I believe most of all in free speech and freedom of movement, choice of movement and life, and love and kindness. And, been with all of this exposure to the polarization of the politics and the medicine and the science, I found it very difficult to be neutral because I've seen scorn and contempt from both sides, and I get caught in the crossfire a lot. But I don't really feel educated enough to know enough about either of these areas. So I'm talking today on behalf of people like me who may have been, may be lost, maybe need to hear someone talk about it from a human point of view without condemnation. And I have, you know, when I come to work, there is, I need to know, for instance, whether I'm playing to a welcome audience or a discriminated audience. I can't play to people that only have vaccine passports. I can't play to people that only follow, you know, that are anti-vaccination. There has to be a way to bring people together. I believe music can do that. But it's a long way away, and maybe that's good because there's still time, I believe, for us to come together. Would love to be fearless, but I'm not. I'm really, you know, I've caught this anxiety syndrome. I have it bad, and I have it as bad as I had maybe 2 or 3 weeks ago when I was devoutly following the 6 o'clock. And the 10 o'clock news or talk radio or trying to find someone who's speaking a language that I can identify with. But now I've stopped watching TV. One of the cartoons was a little drawing of a guy interviewing two Quakers and saying, how come none of your community has got COVID? And they said, well, we don't watch TV. It's so true, man. There's so much of the sickness is in our heads now. We become weak, you know. If we're talking about freedom of speech, freedom of movement, freedom of choice with the vaccine, for instance, then the opposite of that is what we're experiencing. If you take that away, what we're experiencing that disturbs me most is coercion. And I had said to my friend, the doctor, my doctor, I said, do you think this vaccine thing's ever going to become mandatory? He said, ridiculous, ridiculous. They could never they'd never pull that on. I said, well, I got a funny feeling, you know, and bit by bit, it's that. And to see celebrities, especially what really got me was ethnic minority celebrities guilt tripping their own community. That broke my fucking heart. That made me so angry. I have a lot of friends in that part of the world, and to see them preyed on like that, that's where it steps into sadism for me. The photographs of the people on buses with masks on saying, don't let their sacrifice be in vain. Phew, that's bad, that's bad. It's very dark. It's very dark. It's victimization is what it is. I was reading 1984 all through this. And there's something he says. He says, how do you have full control over people? And he said, fear. He said, no, not fear. Suffering is how you get full control over people. And that's what it's come to. But it's psychological suffering, but it's amounts to the same thing. And I experience it. When you get caught in the trap, well, can you believe what your heart tells you is right? Or is it going against the narrative? Can I talk about how I feel to my family? Man, it doesn't get riskier than that. I was asked to do a private gig in the Caribbean after not playing for a long time, and I was in bad shape, recovering from the second jab. And I had to fill in this government questionnaire because I was going to work again. And at some point during this, I had my phone, and my assistant was showing me how to do it on my laptop. And on my phone, this app appeared, and it said, DigiID. And I thought, what the fuck? They can't do that. You can't make me buy an app, the government app. And I deleted it. But then I thought, now this is where it's going to stop. That's what Van says. This is going to stop. And I agree. I agree it's going to stop. But where's it coming from?
Why aren't more people
fear
speaking out?
Fear.
Of what?
Reprisal.